Hi, I'm Mike Chapple, and I'm here today to help you pass your Certified Information System Security Professional, or CISSP, exam. Now, I've been around this test for a long time. I earned my CISSP certification all the way back in 2002, and I've been working with students helping them prepare for the exam ever since. I'm the lead author of the official CISSP study guide from Cybex. That's a comprehensive book that contains all of the knowledge that you'll need to pass the exam. I've also written the official CISSP practice tests, and I have a full video course series on LinkedIn Learning covering this test. So I think it's fair to say that I know this exam inside and out. In the 20 plus years that I've been around this certification, I've learned a lot about what works and what doesn't when it comes to preparing for this test. And in this video, I'd like to share that wisdom with you. I'm going to offer you 10 practical pieces of advice that you should keep in mind when you're preparing for the CISSP. Now, my first piece of advice is what I think is the absolute most important thing that you should keep in mind as you're preparing for the exam and as you're sitting in front of that testing computer. It's that you should act like a CISO, not a technical expert. Remember the focus of this exam. The CISSP is a security leadership certification. It's not meant to prove your technical skills or that you're the smartest engineer on the block. This test is designed to show that you have the skills and the mindset necessary to sit in the most senior cybersecurity seat in an organization, the Chief Information Security Officer. Now, if you haven't been a CISO before, it might be hard to imagine what that seat feels like. I can tell you from experience that it's a challenging role to fill. You're on the hook for protecting the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of your organization's systems and data, that's for sure. But you're also responsible for wearing another hat. You're a senior business leader. It's your job to balance business needs with security requirements. And that means making some tough decisions. We all know that you can always improve your organization's security controls. If you're currently working in security, I know that you have a list in your head of the 10 things that you want to do next to improve your security posture. But you also know that it's just not possible to get all of those things done. You don't have the time, and your organization doesn't have the money. A CISO needs to balance those concerns and find the answer that's good enough. It's a tricky art, but CISOs need to make sure that the organization meets its security requirements without going over. You don't want to overspend on security because that spending is taking away resources from other areas of the organization or its shareholders. So how do you do that? How do you make those tough decisions? Well, do you remember all that risk management material that I discussed in my books and video courses? When it comes down to it, CISOs are risk managers, and they need to make risk-based decisions every day. That leads to my second tip on preparing for the exam. Know the math when it comes to risk management. Quantitative risk assessment has been an important topic on the CISSP exam for as long as I can remember, and I've been doing this for more than 20 years. It's part of the core knowledge of a cybersecurity leader, and you simply need to know how to do the math. Most importantly, you need to know how to calculate the annualized loss expectancy, or ALE, when you're given a situation. I talk about that in my books and video courses. You calculate the ALE by multiplying the single loss expectancy, or SLE, by the annualized rate of occurrence, or ARO. That's equivalent to multiplying the impact of a risk by its likelihood. The SLE tells you how much damage to expect each time a risk occurs, and the ARO tells you how many times a year to expect that risk to occur. So the ALE puts a dollar value on the expected cost of a risk each year. Now, you might find a question asking you to just outright calculate the ALE, and you definitely need to know how to do that. But that's not the end of the story. Remember, you need to think like a CISO, not a technical expert. You not only need to do the math, you also need to know how to apply that math. For example, if you see an exam question asking you to identify whether you should implement a new security control, and it provides you with all sorts of numeric facts about the risk, you're looking at a risk management question. First, calculate the ALE, but then use that ALE to make a decision. How much financial damage can you expect from a risk in a given year? How much does the control cost? Is the control worth implementing? Let me show you a sample question that might help shed some light on the situation. You're the CISO of a large organization, and you're considering purchasing a DDoS mitigation service that costs $20,000 a year. You've consulted with your team, and you've determined that DDoS attacks occur about twice a year. You've also checked with business leaders and determined that the typical attack takes down your sales website for an hour, causing you about $5,000 in lost revenue. Should you purchase the service? Well, let's look at this from a risk management perspective. We know that each DDoS attack causes $5,000 in damage. That's the single loss expectancy. And we know that the attacks occur about twice a year, making the annualized rate of occurrence 2. So we can multiply those numbers together and find that the annualized loss expectancy is 5,000 times 2, or $10,000 a year. But the cost of this DDoS mitigation service is $20,000 a year. That means we'll lose more money by purchasing the service than we will by simply suffering through the attacks. So we shouldn't purchase it. The cost outweighs the benefit. Now, before I move on to my third tip on preparing for the CISSP exam, I'd like to take a moment to invite you to visit my website at certmike.com. On that site, I offer a free study plan to help you prepare for the exam using books and video courses. You don't need to take an expensive boot camp to earn your certification. I'll help you through the entire process from start to finish. Just visit certmike.com, click on the CISSP link, and sign up for my free study group. Also, if you find this video helpful, please click the like button below to help other people discover it. I publish cybersecurity certification content frequently, and if you subscribe to my channel, you'll be among the first to see that content as it comes out. All right, so back to my advice on passing the CISSP exam. Now, I already told you to act like a CISO and not a technical expert, right? My third tip might surprise you then. It's that you need to respect the technology. This isn't a highly technical exam, but if you're going to be a cybersecurity leader, you need to understand the cybersecurity profession. As you look through the exam objectives, you'll discover that there is a ton of technical content in there. You'll need to understand how encryption works, the methods used to secure wired and wireless networks, incident response and forensic procedures, firewalls, endpoint security, and many other technical topics. Now, a lot of people come to me and say that they've gotten advice that the exam isn't technical and they shouldn't focus on technical content. I think they're misunderstanding the advice that they heard. Yes, you do need to think like a manager on the exam. And the most technical answer isn't always correct. But sometimes, technology is the correct way to solve an information security problem. You definitely need to understand the technology of cybersecurity if you're going to pass this test. So let's talk a little more about passing this test. My fourth tip is that you need to understand the adaptive format that's used by the CISSP exam. This is another topic that I get a lot of questions about, so let's dig into it a little bit. Adaptive testing means that the number and content of the questions that you get on your exam are set by an algorithm, and that algorithm is analyzing your performance as you answer previous questions. So how many questions are going to be on your exam? I don't know. I can tell you that you're going to have at least 100 questions on your test, and that you won't have more than 150. To pass the exam, you need to demonstrate proficiency in each of the 8 CISSP domains. As you answer the first 100 questions, the algorithm is assessing whether you've done that. If you reach question 100 and the algorithm is satisfied that you are proficient in all 8 domains, your test is over. Congratulations, you've passed. On the other hand, if you reach question 100 and the algorithm is convinced that you don't know the material, your test is also over, and you're going to have to try again another day. If you get to question 100 and the algorithm is still unsure about your proficiency in one or more domains, it's going to keep asking you questions until it's confident in the result or you reach 150 questions. Whenever the algorithm makes a decision, it's going to end your test and give you your results. There are two important things that you need to keep in mind that come from this adaptive nature of the test. First, the algorithm is constantly evaluating you based on your previous answers, and it's choosing question topics that it needs to know to make a better decision. For this reason, you can't go back and change your answers to previous questions. That would mess up the algorithm. So you need to answer each question correctly the first time. You won't be able to go back later and take another look. That leads to the second issue. You need to budget your time carefully, but it is hard to do that when you don't know how many questions you're going to have. So you need to plan to answer 150 questions. If you run out of time without answering all the questions presented by the algorithm, you fail the exam, so don't do that. You have 3 hours to complete the exam, and you need to plan for 150 questions. If you do the math, that means that you have 72 seconds to answer each question. Now sure, you'll answer some questions more quickly than others, and it is okay to spend a little time on a tricky question, but don't spend 10 minutes fretting over a single question. You won't have time to finish the test. The best way to prepare for this experience is to practice with a timer. Make sure that you have a good internal sense of how long you can spend on each question, and stick to your time budget when you take the test. You don't want to get all the way to the exam day and then fail because you ran out of time. Now I'd like to move on to a few specific cybersecurity topics that you absolutely need to know when you take the test. My fifth tip is that you should definitely understand the different types of service organization control, or SOC audits. These audits are very important today because they're the way that we gain assurance that our cloud providers are implementing the right security controls. Now, we're cybersecurity leaders and risk managers, right? Our organizations are putting a lot of sensitive data into the cloud. So we're going to need assurance that data is being properly protected. SOC audits are the key to gaining that assurance. I've put together a whole separate video for you explaining the different types of SOC audit. Be sure to give it a watch and make sure that you know the different categories of audit and when you'd want to use each one. All right, my sixth tip is that you need to understand the technical details behind cryptography. This means understanding the difference between symmetric and asymmetric cryptography and the types of keys used in each approach. To help you prepare for this material, I have two other videos put together. The first one is an introduction to cryptography. It explains the different types of algorithms and the use of encryption keys. The second video covers digital signatures and explains how you can use asymmetric cryptography to achieve the goal of non-repudiation. My seventh piece of advice for you is to know the ISC squared code of ethics. Now, this isn't complicated, but I can almost guarantee that you're going to see an exam question asking you about this code. You need to not only know the elements of the code, but you also need to understand how it applies in different situations. This is another topic where I have a short free video that will help you learn the essential facts that you need to know. Make sure you watch it before you take the exam. The eighth thing you should know is that human life is always the highest priority for any security program. Now, this won't come up in every question on the exam, but you'll probably see it at least once. If you see a question that's talking about an organization's response to an emergency situation or a physical security incident, have the mantra in the back of your head that physical safety is the most important thing. If you're being asked what you should do first or what you should prioritize, look for an answer that's referring to evacuating people or taking other actions that would ensure their physical safety. That's the priority, and it's the correct answer. Now, my ninth tip might sound obvious at first because you've been hearing it from every teacher that's ever given you an exam. Read every question on the exam carefully. This is especially true on the CISSP exam because you'll find some questions that are complex and wordy. There will also be details in some of the questions that aren't really relevant to the answer, but there also might be small details that completely change the correct answer. Now, I know. You only have 72 seconds to answer each question. Make sure that you spend enough time reading the question carefully. And that applies to reading every one of the answer choices as well. If you read a question and see the first answer and say to yourself, "That's it," do not stop there. Many of the questions on the exam are going to ask you to find the best solution. That means that more than one answer might be correct, and you're looking for the best one. If you stop at that first answer, you might not notice that the third or fourth answer choice is an even better solution. Read every question carefully. Finally, to borrow a meme, Keep calm and carry on. This exam is a marathon, not a sprint. Don't get hung up on any question, and don't worry about getting answers wrong. It's very unlikely that you're going to get a perfect score, and you don't need a perfect score. You just need to pass. The adaptive algorithm might throw some hard questions at you as it tries to figure out how much you know. That's okay. Keep calm and carry on. Now, one last note on that topic. ISC squared may also throw some experimental questions on your exam. They do this to test new questions or topics before they appear as real exam questions. So if you see a question on a topic that you know nothing about, you should still try to answer it, but don't panic. You might be looking at an experimental question. Now, those are my 10 tips for passing the CISSP exam. If you'd like more advice like this, please remember to visit my website at certmike.com and sign up for my free study group. I can't wait to help you on your security certification journey. Good luck on the CISSP exam.